Welcome everybody to the Unapologetic Queens Radio Show.
I'm Tylea.
I'm Christina.
And who are we here with? Introduce yourself to our lovely, lovely people.
Hello, everyone. I'm Nikki MG of Tiger Swan Timeless Boutique.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome, welcome. Ladies, how's your week? We start out the show with how our weeks have been.
Always.
Let's see, it's just Tuesday, right? my week has been, I've been blessed this week. Let's see, yesterday I just got back from North Carolina. I was there for a wonderful national gathering put together by a group called BOLD, Black Organizing for Leadership and Dignity. It's where a lot of the organizers and thought leaders, fundraisers, healers, all the beautiful black magic leaders basically of the movement get to come together, strategize, support each other, and learn tools and skills to cope and just, you know, lead better and transform. So that was very powerful, and I just got back from that, so I'm feeling still very elevated and inspired.
Oh, that's so dope.
Yes, yeah. That sounds like a nice little refresher.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Baptism in blackness real quick.
Yes, yes.
So they should have called
me. It was.
I love it.
It was. Yes.
That's what I like to hear. I guess I'm next. This past week has been pretty good. It's all been a blur. I got the opportunity to see Get Out. It's a great movie. Did you see it?
Yes.
Oh, my gosh. I saw it on Sunday and, bro.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to ruin anything about the movie, but it does. It will have you looking at your less melanated brother and like.
Mm-hmm.
And I got to enjoy the Oscars as well. I was very proud of Viola, proud of Moonlight.
Yeah, Moonlight was a really great movie. Yeah.
I didn't get the chance to see it, but I was cheering for off the principle. I was like, yes!
Yes, because Mahershala Ali has come up all the way. Like,
he deserves.
He's such a great actor.
He's been around for like how long?
Is it like 16 years?
We were talking about it at my job today because I work at a theater, and it's like, you know, being an artist is one of the hardest jobs because it'll take you, you'll be working forever before people, like, before you make it. And it seems like you're an overnight success. Meanwhile, you've been around for 16 years.
Right. So, and like, even just in the past 3 or 4 years, he was in, like, Hunger Games. He was in Divergent, I believe, too. I'm almost like, yo, like, you everywhere.
I got everywhere.
Then he was in all those shows, too. He was already on House of Cards. Like, I've been looking back. And, I was
and
like,
Luke Cage.
Yes, and Luke Cage. Yeah. So
yeah, he's doing it.
It's just like with Taraji. I mean, but you know, it takes a longer time for black actors to make it, quote, unquote.
I don't.
Yeah.
It's so sad.
It stresses me out. She knows I act. So I'm like,
I will be like, how old by the time anyone knows? Yeah.
But,
unless. You talk to Jordan Peele.
I know, right? Hey, Jordan, how you feeling?
Right, shoot. Get come up. I mean,
horror.
Honestly, mad people used to come up off of Tyler Perry.
Tyler Perry Studios. People used to not bang with Tyler Perry. A lot of people who I know who were actors and actresses didn't bang with Tyler Perry. But now people out here like, man, I'm trying to get a job at Tyler Perry Studios. And I'm like, no, are we sure?
Okay, because he literally employs, I'm pretty sure, the most black actors out of anyone in Hollywood.
That's
you
true.
Gotta start somewhere.
Side of the
world. We all we got. Hello.
No. And like, yes. It's grateful. It's good that we're in this black renaissance. So that's how I've been feeling this week. Just happy and kind of planning out my next moves now.
Nice.
See what's happening.
Thinking of a master plan.
Okay. How about you, Tina?
So it's been a very eventful, like, past really 3 weeks, honestly, but. The past week was really dope. Like, I went to the Black Goddess tribute, thanks to you.
How was it?
It was great. It was more than I expected. Like, so, essentially, it was basically, like, they were honoring different black women, like, throughout the ages, like, Pam Grier, Janelle Monáe. That's her everything. And then, you know, some other great black women as well. And then so how they honored them was like with a fashion show. Mm-hmm. So it was in the Congress Heights Arts and Culture Center, and the women would come down in clothes that were made by like the vendors that were upstairs and modeled their asses off. I was like, y'all better do it, okay? Like, I thought it was a real show. Like, if there was a runway, they slayed it. Okay. People were naked. This one girl, she was in the shower, so she had body paint.
I was going to ask, was it body paint?
But the girl who's over Femme Fatale, she, you know, she was topless, essentially. She had her dress, and it was, like, under here, and then, like, just the rest of her dress. And I was like, oh, okay, so this is what we're doing.
It's a ladies only.
Yeah.
Right.
Ladies only.
Yeah, I peeped that. Yeah. I peeped that. They were like, it said strictly ladies only on that invitation. I was like, yes. Yeah, no, this wouldn't have been good if some nigga just rolled in. You know? Hey, no. But it was really nice. It was I feel like all weekend I was in a safe space of black women, mm-hmm. and it was refreshing, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, I did yoga, and it was nice.
Nice.
I felt really black. You know. So, let's talk about Nikki.
Nikki.
So, I met Nikki at Resilience, which was Morgan's event that happened earlier this month.
Mm-hmm.
And Nikki has some great vintage clothes that she just finds from Neverland or something. You know, I don't know where she gets it from, but she... Let's hear more about your business and why you decided to do this.
Sure. So Tiger Swan Timeless Boutique is something that I created just recently. Let me see. It was March of 2016 when I did my first experimental pop-up boutique. And at the time, I was still working as the executive director of DC Jobs of Justice. But I had been doing workers organizing policy work for nearly 8 years. So I just came to a point where I knew I needed a transition. I wanted to utilize more of the creative side of my brain, but really I was inspired by all of the women leaders in the movement. You know, when you think about the civil rights movement or even the movements that are happening right now, a lot of men get credit, mm-hmm. but it's actually a lot of women who are doing the hard work and leading and sparking motion and organizing communities and making the fundraising phone calls. And I just see a lot of women... queens, mm-hmm. Yes. giving everything that they can to help transform the society, but not having a lot of time to be in safe, creative spaces to explore their style, to experiment with their beauty, to talk about their vision of themselves and what they want to project when they're in meeting spaces or when they're out about on town. And so I was like, I love clothes. I particularly love vintage. I love the style of the my heroes, my civil rights heroes, people like Shirley Chisholm, you know, from the 40s, 50s, and 60s. I love that classic vintage style. And so I feel that it's timeless. And I'm like, you know what? Vintage clothes, they're made better quality than what's made today.
Definitely.
And... you know, depending on what it is, it'll look good now and forever. And so I did my first pop-up, like I said, in March of last year. Got a lot of positive feedback and made a transition plan that this is what I was going to do and pursue my dream. And so I started doing style therapy consultations, brunch events full-time, in October of 2016. You asked where I get my clothes from, right. And my accessories, jewelries. So in September, I took a huge road trip up and down the East Coast, primarily the New York and New England area. So I thrifted. I went to vintage places. I went to specialty boutiques and looked for very unique things that you wouldn't be able to find here in the District of Columbia that were super affordable,
mm-hmm.
That I could resell at a very affordable rate. I am a person who grew up poor to middle class, but I don't think that you have to spend a lot of money to be fabulous, you know? And so I really want to just create a space where, you know, you can get some super dope items, like revamp your style or like integrate a couple of things in, but also have someone pamper, nurture you in a creative mental way, have a conversation, you know, about your budget. Like, I go all out. It's an experience that we have, and it's just been wonderful, and yeah.
That's so amazing.
I know!
And style therapy.
Yeah.
So, tell us more about style therapy.
Yeah, so, I'm not gonna lie, I didn't go to, like, design school or fashion school. I'm just someone who has a deep love of vintage style and clothes ever since I was a child. When I was a kid, for hours as an only child, I would entertain myself by drawing three women on a sheet of paper in different outfits. I would just create. I have books of these, and I always had, you know, a subscription to 17 magazine and Vogue.
Yes.
Constantly. And you know what? After like 30 years of that, like, that's a lifetime of research, actually, right, on what is in style, what's transitioning, seeing beauty trends, and it enabled me to have a very clear sense of my own defined style by looking and seeing what's out there, doing the work of actually trying on a lot of different clothes, vintage, different designers and cuts. Like, it's work. I have come to a place where I'm clear and confident about my own personal style. And so what I'm trying to do is help people get to that place. Mm-hmm. So it's not from a technical perspective, right, that I'm doing style therapy. It's from, who are you? What inspires you? What colors do you love? What shapes do you love? Not necessarily what does society say looks good on your color or your shape or your body type, mm-hmm, but what actually makes you happy, that's going to make you confident, so that when you are in different spaces, you as a woman are navigating them in the most confident way. Because when we like the way that we look, mm-hmm, we speak up in business meetings, in community meetings. We get on the radio and we put ourselves in public places because, mm-hmm, we're gorgeous and beautiful. Mm-hmm. And so that's what I'm really trying to help women in individual sessions, and then over time, get to that place, or if they're already in that place, help elevate that by experimenting with different ways to present themselves.
That's so cool.
Right. Yeah. What do you find that, so you said, like, women, we speak up more when we're, you know, we're confident in how we look. What do you think really defines someone's look in terms of, like, I don't know where I was going somewhere, and it was like, it was right here.
I was like, tip of your tongue.
Well, it was like,
well, I think every woman has a different perception of herself, mm-hmm, and, you know, beauty is in the eye of the beholder, and depending on what family you grew up in and what kind of Black love or Asian love or whatever culture, from whatever kind of love and pride of self and culture is instilled in you, or vice versa, what kind of shame or oppression or unfair beauty standards are instilled in you, will over time, you know, shape how you feel about yourself. Mm-hmm. They could define or shape what kind of fashion risks you're willing to take, or what kind of beauty risks you're willing or not to take. And so every single woman, I'll do like an intake survey when they come to me, just to get a baseline kind of sense of how she perceives herself and what she likes about her wardrobe and what she doesn't, you know. My aim is not to take a woman, you know, and completely transform her. It's to get her to a place where she is just more happy and comfortable with the way that she looks. And honestly, a lot of times, in my opinion, the actual garment has nothing to do with that. What's more important is the space to actually talk about why she loves this aspect of her body, why she likes how this fits, why she doesn't like how this fits on her, or why this looks, and actually verbalize what she likes, what she doesn't, and be clear and confident about that, so that when she goes home and she gets dressed, she's like, yes, like this works today. Mm-hmm. I look fly. Whatever that style is, particularly for her, but she walks out of the door, you know, feeling like she can look up in the world.
That's so beautiful. I think we forget how important feeling confident in what you're wearing is.
Yeah, I don't know about y'all, but I got teased a lot as a kid, you know, for wearing this or having that kind of hair, mm-hmm. and, you know, and so I think clothes are not, you know, the answer for confidence, right. but it's an outlet of self-expression.
That's very true. That's very true. What's a common reason you see, like, that people don't like about themselves, or, like, don't like what they're wearing, or, like, a part of their body that's not it.
Well, I think some of the challenges that women face when getting dressed, you know, clothes are made not, you know, they're mass manufactured now, mm-hmm. and so they're not tailored specifically for all of the glorious different body types that exist out there. They're made on dress forms and mannequins that are standard sizes. And so it can be very discouraging to try on clothes that aren't actually made for you. And especially if you are a plus size woman, if you're a woman with curves, you know, just a lot of designers in the past, you know, 50 or 60 years haven't really catered to making clothes that flatter an array of different sizes. And so it can be a lot of work for a woman to find what actually fits and works well for her. And a lot of women get discouraged by finding that, by taking the time, the years, going to different department stores, trying different designers, thrifting, consulting with people. It can be exhausting. And if it's not like if you're a mother, if you're taking care of other family, if you're driven about your career, or just like style isn't something that you're particularly passionate about, you know, it can be, it cannot be developed. One sense of style cannot be developed, you know. And I find that, though, when women come in who do have those kind of time management challenges, or just feel exhausted or overwhelmed, they love coming into my boutique because I'm doing that work for them and helping them and processing with them and being very honest about it with them. I'm not just trying to sell people stuff. Right. We have a transparent discussion about like what their budget is and not going over that, mm-hmm. unless they're very clear that it's okay and not jeopardizing. We have a conversation about that even if they know me or referred to someone, to not feel guilted into getting something even if they don't fully love it. It's really just about facilitating a safe space for about 2.5 hours for them to explore themselves with a trusted person that's not necessarily trying to exploit or like just capitalize on them. In my mind, if you come to my boutique and you have a loving, nurturing experience, you're more likely to come back again in the future and be a long-term client, or like come to my events than like come one time and have a mediocre experience or feel guilty about something. We don't need any more of that as women. So
that's real. Amazing. Yeah, because we're always the last to take care of ourselves.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
We feel guilty over, you know, things that are out of our control, and it's nice to, you know that there's someone out there who's trying to make you feel
beautiful. About you.
Yeah, like just make it about you, because we don't make it about ourselves.
Ever.
Yeah.
What would you say is the first steps to creating your style, or finding out what your style is?
I think, honestly, like, looking at magazines or looking on Pinterest, or different, like, Tumblr sites, just different outlets where you can look at an abundance or plethora of different fashion options, mm-hmm. and literally just, I like that, I don't like that, and, you know, build a collection of images, whether you tear it out of a magazine or it's on your Pinterest or wherever, and, like, build up a collection of images that you like, so you can see, like, oh, this is the style that I want, so then next time you go into a store, boutique, or make a style consultation, you have a sense of what you're looking for, instead of feeling overwhelmed by the zillion different types of things that are out there.
That's so good advice. Especially even with your clothes, like, I was looking at just your rack, and I'm like, what is this? Oh my god, there's so many on. And I really like that you have, do you set that up often, like the photo shoot and the little backdrop? Like,
those are so cute.
So it's something that I started doing this year. Yeah. And it's been such a rewarding experience for me, and I think for the models, the people getting their picture taken. I have an event coming up on March 19th where I will be doing the photo backdrop pop-up, as well as some queenly accessories and things to try on. That'll be at the Vintage Glam Tea Company, which is...
Where is this?
This is a black-owned business in Ward 4, Northwest Washington, D.C.
You girl, you're telling me something right now.
Okay. Place is so adorable. You have to go there. It's owned by a wonderful woman named Miss Robin. Mm-hmm. She lives locally in the neighborhood, you know, and she has super affordable, really cute vintage and secondhand clothing. She does tea parties. She has an event room upstairs with all the, like, porcelain teacups. She'll make the little perfect pinafore, like, sandwiches. She has the most, like, it's so cute. So we're going to do a Vintage Glam Tea Company times Tiger Swan Timeless event called Brunch Boutique Bazaar.
Okay, so we're going.
Right.
March 19th.
So, you know,
You'll be able to shop at Miss Robin's boutique. And believe me, if you have $20, like, you're going to come out with some serious treasure in there. It's really affordable.
Oh, yes. Yes.
We'll have a DJ playing, Mistress Mambo, providing a nice, lovely soundscape.
Right.
And we'll have brunch there, tea, not like a full big brunch, because it's free. This is a complimentary event, also, right?
Well then.
I'll be there with my camera doing portraits of people. Facebook page will be up by tomorrow, so I'll make sure to invite you both, and you can put it out there and invite other people if
gladly.
But that's coming up, and then, you know, I just talked to the wonderful people here at the Life Media Studios. It's Everlasting Life here, and looks like Saturday, May 1st, I'll be doing a pop-up boutique here and a photo sessions well. So, you know, I'm 1 foot forward, building up every day.
Amen. I'm so proud.
You're right.
Thank you.
I love when I can connect people.
Come out on the 19th, y'all.
This is awesome. Thanks for inviting me here. This is Black excellence.
Black excellence.
Literally.
What would you say to someone who had a different style experience? I'm like trying to word it. Okay. Someone who kind of was always told to change their style growing up. Like, I grew up in the church, right? Because my mom's, like, very churchy. And so, like, my mom now used to always jokingly call... Like, she used to be like, you used to dress like Little Lisa Bonet. Because I used to wear whatever. Mm-hmm. I used to wear whatever. But I was like, I look cute. I look great. And then she would be like, what are people at church going to say? And I was like, you can tell them I put it on. But I got so used to, like, dressing a certain way. And then, you know, style change. You go to high school, and then I had a dress code. Mm-hmm. So, like, someone whose, like, styles has been influenced in so many different layers, what advice would you give them? Because I know I'm not the only person like this, and I'm not the only one who had to wear a school uniform growing up.
I think that's very natural for people to go through different phases, to try different things, different parts of their lives, also for family to constantly, and institutions.
Yes. When you gonna straighten your hair? Yeah.
Oh,
yes.
Girl.
I love how y'all
were
like,
oh, right, you yes. look great. I tell you, church phones are the worst. Girl, like, they will tell you how you look.
Yeah.
Even the other day, my coworker was like, why is your hair in a bun? I love when you wear it down. Or I was like, all right. Like, excuse me? I know you mean well, but also she was old. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know what to say.
I know.
Right, because my hairstyle is supposed to affect your life.
I know. You know, I think there's a history of respectability politics that comes from a very real and legitimate place. I'm not defending respectability politics, but I think I understand where it comes from, like in the older generations, you know, with a more intense level of white supremacist violence and just trying to survive and like not be seen. You know, like I understand where that fear kind of comes from to protect. But so I think when we engage, you know, Ms. Dorothy and whatnot, at the church feels like that, you know, it's just smile and, oh, you look lovely today too. Thanks so much. I'll see you. And keep it pushing.
Be blessed.
You know, exactly. Be blessed. And you know, in a way that's agitational because if you're at church, right, people are supposed to be just thinking about the glory of the Lord and accepting each other, especially as women, so I might have to remind them a little bit about
sister.
But I really think that it's natural for people's style to change over time, over different ages, and what I think is really beautiful is when a person becomes clear and confident about exactly who they are, and all of those different style elements over time like blend together into something very unique on that individual that, you know, nobody else can replicate. So
I feel that. I feel that. Especially since I'm a person who, like, went from pretty much all, like, not hippie clothes. I can't say that. Like, preppy clothes in, like, middle school, high school, and it with a mix of, like, South Pole and, like, you know, like...
Yeah, had our the
big fat
face.
Yeah, out here in Hollister, like, we trying to be with the white kids for real. Like, you know, like, I went through that. And then, you know, I started going through my grandma's closet a lot more. And then, especially, even after my great-aunt passed, like, sophomore year, I really went through her closet, and I got a lot of pieces that I wear a lot to this day. Like, that shirt I was wearing in that picture, that's one of my aunt's shirts. And so it's like, I let myself be influenced more so by their style, and I'm kind of like finding myself in their style. I just wish that I could, you know, tailor all the clothes, because like some of the time, like, I'm stretching it worse. I'll be like, man, I know this is too big, but I like these pants. Like,
you know, go pin them up in the
No, sometimes you just gotta get the right belt.
True. And I like supporting black businesses, so I'm obviously gonna get like shirts like that, and then so it's interesting to move, like, meld them together, like the present stuff that is like cool and quirky, and then like the really vintage stuff that is like, girl, where'd you get that? Like, you know, it's interesting. So do you see a lot of people like that, or
that's my favorite. I love mixing modern and vintage together. I love mixing different genres together. And I think what I see a lot of here in DC. I certainly see a growing community of creatives that are mixing modern and vintage and making their own clothes and accessories as well. But here in the Washington, D.C. area, I see a lot of, like, safe dressing, you know, suits and government office kind of appropriate clothes. I also just, I mean, I used to work in the restaurant industry forever, so I just see a lot of, you know, like, uniforms, various types of uniforms. It's very expensive to live here in the district, and if you don't have a salary job, chances are you have two or three jobs. So, like, you're kicking it with your style whenever on your Monday or Tuesday when you have off. I think that Washington, D.C. has, and surrounding areas, has a lot of room for the arts and culture to expand. And so I'm just really excited to be one of the entrepreneurs, community folks who's here right now to help build up spaces for that, because we need it.
I agree,
yeah. After undergrad, I felt like my style got very safe again. We're all Black. All Black too. Just a lot of
Especially because she was working in restaurants. I was working in retail. Like, I had to wear pretty much all Black.
You can't come out of it.
Yeah.
When I saw you did ROC, that's how I got my bartending certification.
Ah!
When I heard everybody, I was like, oh my goodness.
Yes.
That's what I did.
Yes. I'm a founding member of Rock DC.
Rock DC.
Yes.
Okay.
We're learning about it at the Flit. Because restaurant workers barely have rights. So
I know.
Good for people to let you know what they are.
Yes. Speaking of which, I hope you know, in Washington, D.C., if you work in a restaurant, you currently are entitled to a $12.50 minimum wage. Also, you are entitled to 3 to 7 paid sick days per year. And you're also entitled to wage theft protection. If your wages are stolen, there's actually a law now that you can reclaim them. And the DC Council just passed universal paid family medical leave. So if you have to take care of yourself or an elder for an extended period of time, you can do that, get your job back, and be paid. It would be through a citywide insurance program. Now, there's a lot of opposition to it. There's some council members who have tried to introduce an alternative and are... Mayor Ms. Bowser has not signed and is not in favor of it, but it still exists, and so it's exciting to see over the next couple of years how hopefully people are able to access it and how that transforms their lives as the government implements all of these laws that literally just passed over the last couple of years. So that's why I wanted to take the moment to actually say those things, because you know, a small group of people push those laws forward but have limited capacity to be on the radio and be flyering and at churches to make sure that everyone and their mama and their grandmother knows,
right.
Especially us Black folks, that they have the right to these incredible advances, especially in like low wage restaurant workplaces.
I'm so glad you said that. I'm going to pass it on to my old coworkers.
Please do. They can find more information probably at the Rock DC website, or there's also a website, knowyourrightsdc.org.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let them know. See, I mean, man, that used to be the worst. You know, working in retail, I'm working in restaurants. You don't work, you don't get paid. This happens, you don't get paid. You get sick, you don't get paid. Like, either way, right. Like, no matter what I do, I won't get paid. And people were making, I remember at my job, like, I negotiated my butt off when it came to my like hourly wage, because I was a host. But I knew someone who like came in making like $3-4 less than me, and I was like, and you know, you're not supposed to discuss like what you make or whatever, because that whatever. But I was just like, there's no reason. That is like highway robbery. So shout out to Rock DC.
Yeah.
And forgive me about turning certification.
Right. I just hope, you know, with this new administration that nothing is changed. You know, he's already trying to come back with the whole decriminalization of a certain herb.
Yeah, I didn't appreciate that. I was like, wow, bro. Wow. It's so good. So I have a random question. You said you read a lot of magazines. We all here have read a lot of magazines. I know you're so happy, especially yes. 17. Mm-hmm. So you know how they'll have like, oh, what's your style? Sporty or boho? Or like, you know how like they had in categories. Uh-huh. How do you feel about style categories? Because one thing I always was like, dang, like I don't fit in one. Because I wear like something of everything.
Right.
So, yeah, I think that people feel differently, like, on different days of the week or even, like, different seasons. People feel different year to year. And so you might be feeling a little sporty one day, depending on what events you go to. You might be feeling bohemian, like, maybe you have a concert to go to or, like, you want to go to the park and be beautiful and read a book, you know, and be seen. So yes. You can... I like to have a variety of style options in my closet. I'm not like, I only dress in vintage. I'm not in anything vintage today, except my ring is a replica, but otherwise this is a thrifted shirt. This is from Forever 21. I have Hawaiian print Vans on, you know.
She's swaggy.
Swagmaster flex.
I'm feeling a little swaggerific today. Yesterday I was feeling super casual, so I was like cute in my Beyonce sweatshirt and sneakers. Tomorrow, who knows, I might rock a vintage dress and put victory rolls in my hair. I think you can... I like to, when I get up in the morning, assess how I'm feeling, what I want my day to be like, and try to dress according to that. Not like, oh, I'm in sporty mode this right. season. It's just like, how do I feel today? And put it together. If I like the clothes that I purchased and I like my body, then I should be able to put together, you know, something with what I have and make it work.
Awesome.
That's great.
Take that to heart. Because people be like, what's your style? And I was like, mood ring. Because it depends on how I feel.
Exactly.
Stop judging.
So,
yeah.
Yeah,
like totally. Like,
mood ring.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's funny. Snaps. I was definitely going to say something.
You said, it's okay. It's okay.
I was like, wait.
Because I have another question to do. Think of your question.
That's great.
Okay. So... hair and makeup, style-wise. Like, you know, clothes are one thing. Like, how do you, like you said, experimenting. I know, I would not speak for all black women because I don't like when people do that. I know I'm, like, very careful about my hair. I'm like, I want to experiment. And then I'm like, no. Like, the other day, literally it was, like, 2 weeks ago, I was like, man, I'm about to go get an undercut. Turned out I got home too late. Barbershop was closed. Kind of a good thing. And then, like, this week, I was like, why was I thinking of doing that?
Bro, so, I was thinking about getting an undercut, too.
I really have not thought that was a shame. I had epic, and I had a shame on my hair. Like,
I see some women with super dope undercuts.
What?
I'm like, ooh, it's modern. It looks
it's
good.
Fun. I told myself, I was like, I'm going to get an undercut that's, like, arrows, because I always, ever since I was little, I was obsessed with the arrows.
Uh-huh.
And then I was like, I'm going to cut some bangs.
Uh-huh.
And then some, like, blunt bangs that are kind of long, and wear my hair in a bun.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, after 2 weeks, I'm about to be like...
That'll be cute.
And it sounds so cute, right?
Yeah.
So anyway, what would you tell people who want to experiment with their hair but, like, are afraid of, like, cutting and coloring and, like, things like that?
That's so real. Because I'm one of those people.
She knows. I dyed my hair red 2014. It was, like... It was red. Like,
she was like... Oh, no.
She was like... After it was done, I was like, so how long can I dye my hair back black without it falling? Because it's so scary when you first do it. But yeah. It was like one of the best things I've ever done in my life.
Well, you know, for black women in particular, our hair is so dope. You know, we can put our hair into any shape, literally. And... I think that for anyone that's afraid of experimenting, this might sound harsh, but get over it. Like, your hair is going to grow back, and especially if you're a black woman, there are so many hairstylists. Like, hair is our thing. That's what we do. There is a black woman or a black man out there who can help you
if you're not happy with the experiment you did, get to a place so you're happy with looking at yourself again. There's like, your hair can be that short, and you can get braids put in your hair. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Or you can get a weave or a fabulous wig. Like, I'm at some of the Femme Fatale DC events. Mm. I think it's the Vintage Hoochie, if you follow her on Instagram. Mm. She is so fly. She rocks, like, the cutest little, like, light pink wig, and she looks sexy, original, super fly. And, you know, it's just, like, if you love yourself, you'll like your hair. And if you don't like it, then, you know, find something else temporarily. It'll grow back. But right. You'll never know unless you try.
So true. And your hair will make, I don't want to, like, don't quote me on this, but like, it will make you boss up and you have, you'll grow to, like, when I dyed my hair red, there was nothing I could do after that.
Yeah.
Like, that was it. I was like, you know, I gotta grow my hair out, because you can't dye it, you'll ruin your hair. Yeah. So my confidence level had to match where my hair was, because you're not gonna not get attention as a black girl right here.
Yeah.
So, for anyway, and then my last sister just dyed her hair blonde, and it looks great, but she was terrified of it. She was like, oh my God!
Yeah.
Like, so, when you kind of get over it, I'm talking myself up too.
Be bold.
Get the undercut.
Be bold. You know, I say do it. Try it.
What about makeup? Those who like to experiment with makeup.
You know, I'm not someone that likes to wear a lot of makeup myself. But I envy women that know how to actually
beat their face, right?
Yeah, and create all these beautiful, like, I'm bad with getting the eye, with all the cool designs. I wish I could do that stuff. I say for people that want to experiment with makeup, though, like, go to Nordstrom's or the Bobbi Brown counter or the MAC counter. Like, make yourself a free appointment and, you know, get a consultation with somebody. And especially go on, like, a slower day, like a Monday or a Tuesday, when a makeup artist can actually sit with you and give you the time and attention. And, like, try a look. Try that aquamarine lipstick that you see all the beautiful Black Magic girls doing, but you're afraid to try it. It wipes off. Right. You know, go. And there's a lot of malls and a lot of shopping departments around, so you can go ahead and make yourself a little appointment, you know, book yourself something for free once a week for a month, and then, like, have four different experiment looks and see which products you like, how they feel on your skin, because makeup can be overwhelming and skincare can be overwhelming. There's so many products out there that for someone like me, I need guidance, and that's why I'm starting to bring a makeup artist along to my photo shoots.
Hey,
the Brunch Boutique Bazaar event, so you will get your photo and a little quick makeup too. It'll be extra cute.
That is so dope. I can never master a smoky eye.
Me either.
Ever. I look crazy every time.
Me too.
I look like I got beat up. Literally, I'm trying to do smoky eyes, and I'm like, I look like I have two black eyes. But that's because, like you said, I went to MAC when I was a freshman because I was a broadcast journalism major, and one thing was, like, you always have to look, like, beat. And so I was like, you know, can you do natural for me? And so that's how I learned to do makeup and make it look natural.
Yeah.
And, like, the trick with that was I bought all skincare products instead of, no, I bought some makeup, but I bought, like, you know, skin lotion and makeup remover to, like, balance it out. But I need to go to have somebody teach me how to do a smoky eye, because I'm sick of looking like a raccoon.
Yeah.
Every single time I try, I just look terrible.
And I'm somebody who literally has a mom who never put on makeup, like, who just put on, like, some lipstick. That's the only
mom
makeup.
Too.
Like,
that lipstick on a woman with no makeup, with just lipstick, is a very sexy, like, dangerous woman look. It's one of my favorite looks. No makeup and just lipstick.
Yes, that's pretty much about as far as I go too. So unless somebody decides to do my eyes, like, I have friends who be like, "Oh, let me play with your eyes." But it's like, for me, especially because my skin is so sensitive, I'm like afraid to touch makeup because it's like,
Your skin is gorgeous. Yeah. You don't.
But it's like
it.
Super sensitive. That's why. So I'm like, as soon as I put anything on it, it's like red. Like, I'm like, okay.
Yeah.
I didn't mean to.
That's probably why it would be good to go to, you know, like, the Nordstrom's counter and talk to a makeup professional that can help you with that. So you're not getting products that have
irritant materials in them. They can recommend things more with, you know, like a water base or just shea butter, safer materials or whatever for your skin type.
That's real.
Yeah.
Especially skin makeup is very difficult. As someone who's team in between, as people like to shade me, but people who are like not light and not really dark, who are just in between, always have issues with skin makeup. I always had issues with foundation. And like, I had a choir teacher who was like, a grown woman looks incomplete without makeup. I remember her saying that in high school, and in high school I didn't wear makeup, and so I was like, nah. But it is true. You do want to learn about yourself.
Yeah.
So, and a wing, that's always what I want to master. My wings look aight. But sometimes, you know how you, like, see people and their wing is, like,
perfect. Yeah.
And they have, like, dots along that. They're just color popping. If that's you, you're great. You're great.
I think that's a liquid liner. I don't know if those crowns be working.
Like the crowns they don't wear. Crowns are good for me because I like makeup. I wear makeup. I'm not wearing any today other than lip. So.
Okay.
But crowns and, like, pencils are good for bottom eyeliner, which you have to be careful with, make sure it doesn't run because you look like a bat. But liquid I always do for my, like, attempt at a wing.
Yeah.
Or, like, the marker style.
Yeah, I used to have, back in the day. It wasn't the, like, the paint kind, though. Mm-hmm. Like, it was kind of like a marker low-key, but, like, it came up like a pencil.
Mm-hmm.
So
that sounds cool.
It was cool. I liked it.
Yeah, get that junk. One thing I always do, which is random, I think people should do it too. If you have moles on your face, I think people don't like moles, right? But I have like a mole near my eye. Mm-hmm. So like whenever I do my liquid eyeliner, I put eyeliner on my mole to darken. Which is like really weird.
Make it pop.
Make it pop. My friend has a mole by her lip. She always darkens her.
Yeah, because it's cute. I mean, that's like, I feel like that's one of those cute skin, whatever, you know, that are really like quirky and like,
and it makes you like it.
Sexy. You know?
Moles and freckles,
And then it's like, the other thing is that I have my birthmark, and then people used to say, like, oh, why don't you put makeup on it? And I'm like, because I don't have to put makeup on it.
Right, it's like, my birthmark. It's my signature.
You know, like, that might be something that also probably, like, deterred me away from using skin makeup, because people expected me to cover up my birthmark like it was ugly or something. I'm like, you don't even notice this when I have my hair, like, in a certain way. Like, you know, like, I'm just like, but then some people really think, like, I got hit. So, it's sad. If you all can see.
Maybe I'm so used to your face that it's not noticeable anymore.
I don't even see it in the mirror anymore. Honestly, like, it's like, unless somebody said something to me recently, then I won't remember it's there.
People draw me when it comes to, like,
you know, like, this is my face. Can you get off my face?
Exactly. Work on yourself.
Please.
Yeah.
Stay in your lane.
Yeah. People always have ignorant things to say.
Oh, my God. So, this lady in my church, she was like, she, you know, like, when you get older, a lot of black women tend to gain weight. So, you know, she had normal older women weight. And this woman came up to her. She's like, you know, I like you fat.
Dad, I know my response was dramatic. Like, how dare you say that?
I was like,
why would you say that? And you said it loud so other people could hear.
Oh, no, she told us the story.
Oh.
If I had heard that, I would have been like,
I wonder what their relationship
I hope they were close.
I'm telling you. No, I'm sure they were. Yeah, she just said it was like, you know, people you see in the church, like, in one of those church conferences type things, because we used to go up and down Jersey for church conference. So it's like, you're just a peer, and you're talking about, I like you.
You don't know what I'm going through. I could be eating because of emotions. That's why I can go home and eat more.
Like, what? That's another thing. Like, we gotta stop tearing each other down like that.
Body shaming is...
Yeah, speaking of tearing each other down, how do y'all feel about the Nicki Minaj Remy Ma?
Haven't heard Nicki's response.
Nicki didn't have response. She doesn't have a response yet.
Well,
not that I heard.
Gucci Mane have a song called Make Love.
But that's what started it.
Oh.
Remy Ma was, like, responding to that song.
I thought there was something else from, like, the past that had started it and instigated.
It was, like, so people... And you know one thing? This speaks to how society pits women against each other. Like, rap beefs are a thing, but, like, they always act like there can only be one queen of rap. And I don't like that. Because y'all be like, oh, Jay-Z and Kanye, why can't it be Nicki and Remy?
Right.
But I remember, because I did hear that the Make Love song, and I heard, like, her shot, and I was like...
It's pretty whack.
But it was not memorable. I don't remember. No, that's the thing. It wasn't, and I love Nicki Minaj.
Me too.
Yeah, like literally, I love Nicki Minaj.
But
I
think it was disappointing.
It was, I ride for Nicki. I'd be like, Nicki's talented. She went to LaGuardia. She can get it. Like, I'm always riding for her. But I was like, she like fired a shot at Remy Ma. I knew she was gonna be annihilated. When I heard that song, I said, you ain't wanna start that.
I think she. So in the song, in the Make Love song, basically, just to summarize, she talks about how much money she has and how, like, every woman has gotten ass implants and pink wig just like her. She's basically just talking about, like, how big she is and how awesome she is, and says very little, actually, about Remy Ma.
Right.
And, I mean, part of it's cute, you know, like, she laughs and giggles and does her and everything, yeah. But she really doesn't say a whole lot. It's, like, maybe, like, 32 bars or something, whereas Remy Ma has a 7-minute opus.
Yeah, that joke's crazy. I was like, dang, I watched it on YouTube, and I saw the time, I was like...
I know.
Every time I thought it was over, it was like, another one. Like,
another one. Right. It's like, I went and talked to so-and-so, and this is what they said about you, and then I went and talked to so-and-so.
Right.
And then I went and talked to so-and-so, and they confirmed what they said about you, and then I'm going on your family. She went on every single thing of her life. I'm like,
She wrote a novel.
She really did. And condensed it to 7 minutes. I don't understand. I'm waiting on Nikki's response to that, because you have to respond.
She has to.
Like, you can't not.
Her boyfriend are having, like, they lost.
Her ex.
To Drake. Oh, when did they break up? I'm behind.
I know. I'm like, is she still with me?
Oh, yeah, no. They broke up, like, 2-3 weeks ago, maybe? Maybe longer.
Okay.
Don't quote me. But, yeah. And then, also, Nikki, love you dearly, but don't talk about wigs, because Lil' Kim was wearing wigs. Forever ago. Oh. Don't. I love Lil' Kim, even though I shouldn't for no reason. Like, when I listen to
that. I love Lil' Kim too. We all do.
Like, when I was little, I was like, why was I saying, like, how did I know
that? Right, we shouldn't have listened to her at all.
Like, I was listening to No Time with her and Diddy. This song came out in 95. And I was like, I used to always sing the Poo Naughty part. Not knowing what I was saying, but I was just like, yo. Yeah, I don't know. We'll see how this goes.
We'll see.
I mean,
it's entertainment.
Issa Rae jumped in with the tweet, don't meet this up. Nikki, comma, don't meet this up.
Like, boom! That is funny.
Trey made a video response to the Trey Edison Remy Ma. He's like, y'all, like, nah. I was like, people are getting involved. Like, this is crazy.
Everyone is involved.
That is too much. First of
all, with the sheather.
She really, like, but what somebody said to me was that, you know, she sat there and she built up all this information. She hasn't, you know,
she was locked up for how long?
Exactly. So
all she had to do was make a list. No shame for me. I don't want no problem.
So it's like, it's not like she came at it with a freestyle for real. You know,
it's not the slow.
Exactly. So I'm like, you know, we can't really be like, you know, dang, like, you know. This is just Nikki's life. And it just happens to be, like, you know.
But even so, like, Remy goes, like, hard and steady, like, and consistent for that whole 7 minutes. I like to write haikus and a couple bars from time to time.
Okay.
You know, from time to time. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying, like, to go 7 minutes consistently and not really skip a beat, like, that's still talent.
Yeah,
like,
so.
Yeah. Like, she was just, like, having a conversation.
It was rumors of that being a freestyle. Rumors. I was like, that just makes it even more dope.
Wow.
Like, you had a bullet point of all this, and you just freestyled based on your bullet points, then...
Yeah.
Brava.
Right.
Do you like Remy?
I do. I can't... I'm gonna be honest. I don't have, like, Remy Ma CDs, you know, that I collected back in the day, or even... like, a lot of her tracks on my favorite playlists and whatnot, but, like, her tracks that she's on with the Terror Squad, you know, like, I mess with. All the Way Up is one of my favorite songs.
Yes!
yes, that song, and you know, so actually this whole beef actually has made me, like, this morning I was listening to Remy Ma's first album because I was just like, let me go back and see, you mm-hmm. know, like, what she's really about mm-hmm. aside from dissing another queen. What would it be like if we were in a world without beef rap?
Right. That's true. That's true. And that's, so part of me is like, you know, is this for a show? Or are they just gonna come back and be like, all right, let's make an album? Like,
right, JK, but after that 7 minutes, because I thought the same thing. I was gonna be little jabs here and there.
You never came working with Remy Ma.
Yeah, she can't. Yeah, she just came for everything. I was like, wow.
Yeah.
That is true. We did have a world without beef rap for a little while. And then Meek and Drake happened.
Right, right.
And I don't even know if that counts.
that wasn't even real. Like, I feel like they, I have a theory. I just feel like they knew, like, this is going to be a publicity stunt, and then Meek decided to take the L. Because I was really like, sir.
But, damn, like.
Sir. I was like, you're not from Philly no more, from Chester. Like, you're not allowed to claim
for the city. I don't know if he really, you know, because,
well,
like.
According to Nicki, or according to Remy, Nicki Minaj helped instigate that whole beef rap. Because she, I forget what she said in the song exactly, but.
That's true.
I don't want to repeat any lines from the
right,
but it's like, Meek, you lost to a Blackberry freestyler. Like, maybe I just like hip hop too much, so I'm sorry, I'm going too into it. But I was just like, really, like, my dude freestyles from his Blackberry. You lost to him, sir. Not that I can rap, Drake. I'm not trying to battle you either.
No, you know, Ty has some bars though. I ain't gonna fight. You know,
thank you.
A little cypher, and she jump in. I'd be like,
yeah, I'm like the only girl with all the guys. Like,
and I'd be there like, hey.
That's when you're like haikus and bars. I'd be like, yeah, girl.
You, between you and Justice, I tell you, you could have a little rap duo here. You know what I'm saying? Like. Shoot, but that's not my portion. That's not my no. You know, maybe give me like a few notes.
Can sing a little bit.
But we're almost out of time.
You know,
tell people where they can find you, and reiterate that date one more time. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. So, truth be told, my website is going to be launched next week.
Hey, I quit on it.
It will be tigerswantimeless.com. But in the meantime, you can follow me on Instagram and Facebook. Follow at tigerswanstyle, both on Instagram and Facebook. Again, at tigerswanstyle. And if you're interested in a style therapy consultation or helping me, or I'm sorry, me coordinating an event for you or something, you can always email me tigerswanstyle@gmail.com. Everything's tigerswanstyle.
Yes, yes. Yeah. Make it easy for the folks.
Yes.
Oh, when's your event again?
So the next Brunch Boutique Bazaar will be Sunday, March 19th from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. at the Vintage Glam Tea Company, and that's right at 2nd and Kennedy Streets, Northwest Washington, D.C.
Okay.
Yes.
Cool beans. I'm excited.
Yeah. I'm excited, too. I can't wait to be there.
Yay!
Super cute.
And with that, we are out of time. Bye, guys.